first exercise in pre-lesson 20, it asks us which ordered pair xy is a solution to 2x plus 4y equals 16. So how are we going to solve that? Well, we know that our solution is whatever would make the equation true. So I have my four different options, and I know that my first value is going to be my x, and my second is my y. So I'm just going to test each value to see if my equation becomes true. So in this first one, I put in, my first number is a 0, so I put in 0 where the x goes. My second number is a 4, so I put in the 4 where the y goes. 2 times 0 becomes 0, 4 times 4 becomes 16, and 0 plus 16 is 16. So that is a true statement, which would make 0 for a solution. Let's test 8, 0. If I plug in 8 where the x goes and 0 where the y is, I get 2 times 8, which is 16, plus 4 times 0, which is 0, equals 16. 16 plus 0 is 16. Since 16 equals 16 is true, I know that I found the solution. Let's test 1, 4. We're going to put in a 1 where the x is and a 4 where my y is. 2 times 1 is 2. 4 times 4 is 16. 2 plus 16 equals 18. 18 is not 16, so that one is not a solution. So I'll put an x by it. Let's test 2, 4. Put in a 2 for the x and a 4 for the y. So I get 2 times 2 is 4, plus 4 times 4 is 16. Well, 4 plus 16 is 20, and 20 is not 16. Since that is false, that is not a solution. So in this lesson, we are going to solve equations as a process of answering a question. Which value makes the equation true? Okay, here's a question from the quiz that you can go over. You can do that on your own time. Okay, so getting back to our lesson. So here we want to complete the table of values to find solutions of linear equation. The linear equation is x plus y equals 5. So this is the equation that I'm dealing with, and I have a table. And this table has all of my x values filled out. So what we're going to do is we're going to take each x, and we're going to say, if x is negative 4, what number y would make this true? So I need negative 4 plus y equals 5. Well, I can solve for y by adding 4 to both sides, and I'll get y equals 9. Negative 4 plus 9 is 5. So as a pair, negative 4 plus 9. I write it as the xy pair. And that is a solution to x plus y equals 5. So now I'm just going to do the same thing for each number. Negative 3 plus y equals 5. What number would make this true? Well, we know that negative 3 plus 8 equals 5. So 8 is the y that I need here. Negative 3, 8 is the pair. Next, I'm going to try negative 2. Negative 2 plus what number equals 5? Negative 2 plus 7 equals 5. So 5 is the y that I need. And my point is negative 2, 5. Let's do one more. Negative 1 plus y equals 5. What number plus a negative 1 would equal 5? Whoops, I wrote that wrong. Okay, so here we're going to have negative 1 plus 6. 6 is the number that I need to get equal to 5. So I have 6, and I have the point negative 1, 6. I can go through and I can fill out the rest of my table in the same way. 0 plus what number equals 5? 0 plus 5 is 5, so I get the point 0, 5. 1 plus 4 is 5, so I get the point 1, 4. 2 plus 3 is 5, so we get the point 2, 3. 3 plus 2 is 5, so we get 3, 2. 4 plus 1 is 5, so we get 4, 1. And 5 plus 0 is 5, so we get the point 5, 0. Again, we could solve each one of those. We could substitute the value in for x and solve for y in each case, or we can reason it through mentally. So our next question here asks us, what is my x-intercept? Well, when I look on my graph, I know that every single point along my x-axis has a y value of 0. So when I'm looking for my x-intercept, I need to say, well, where is the y 0? Here I have 0 for my y, and my x value was 5. So my x-intercept is 5, or the point 5, 0. For my y-intercept, when I look at my graph, I know that every single point along the y-axis has an x value that is 0. So to find the y-intercept, I say, where is x 0? Well, here is where x is 0, and the value is 5. So my y-intercept is also 5. Next, we want to plot our points. So each one of these points in my table, I can put on the graph. And I know that to plot my points, I always start in the middle of the graph, and then my x value tells me how far left or right to go, and the y value tells me how far up or down. So to plot the point negative 4, 9, I'm going to count 1, 2, 3, 4, up 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. To plot the point negative 3, 8, I'm going to count 3 to the left and up 8. To plot should be negative 2, 7. Oh, I missed the value. Okay. Sorry about that. Should be 7 in there. Let's go back and fix that. I should have, good, negative 3 plus 8, and I wrote 7, but then I wrote it incorrectly over there. So now that we fixed that, okay. To plot the point negative 2, 7, I'm going to go left 2 and up 7. To plot the point negative 1, 6, I'm going to go left 1 and up 6. To plot 0, 5, I start at 0, I go up 5. Then I have 1, 4, 2, 3, 3, 2, 4, 1, and 5, 0. And when we look at these points, what do we notice? Well, they're all forming a line. And since my equation is x plus y equals 5, I can pick any two numbers that I want. So there's nothing that stops me from picking a fraction or a decimal for x. So I'm going to go ahead and connect all of those dots to say that every single point along this line would be a solution to x plus y equals 5. Okay, so looking at number 3, here we're going to do the same thing as what we did in number 2, except in number 2 we had a whole ton of points. Well, I don't always need that many points to make my line. To make my line, I can really get away with just 2 or 3 points. So for my new equation here, x plus 2y equals 4, we have a much smaller table. We're going to fill it out in the same way. For x equals 0, I'm going to say 0 plus 2y equals 4. Put in the 0 where the x was. So now I need to solve for y. Well, I know this is the same thing as 2y equals 4. If I divide both sides by 2, then I'm left with just y on the left, and 4 divided by 2 is 2. So in my table, I'm going to put in a 2, because I know that if x is 0, y has to be 2 to make the equation true. Well, what if y is 0? Now I'm going to go put in a 0 where the y is and see what x I need to make the equation true. So I have the x. I'm going to bring that down. 2 times 0 is 0, and that's equals to 4. And x plus 0 is the same thing as just an x, so I know I need x to equal 4. So I'm going to fill in that 4 in my table because I know that if y is 0, I need x to equal 4 to make the equation true. Now, let's plug in that 1. If x equals 1, 1 plus 2y equal to 4. Well, 1 plus 2y, to solve for y, I'm going to subtract that 1 from both sides, bring down the 2y, 4 minus 1 is 3, and then divide both sides by 2 to get the y by itself. So I need y equals 3 halves, which is the same thing as 1.5. So in my table, I can either write 3 halves or 1.5. I'm going to leave it as a fraction because I like fractions, but you could write it as a decimal. Now I want to go ahead and plot those points. And so I know that each value in my table can be written as a point. The 0, x, and the y, 2, is the point 0, 2. So on my graph, I'm going to go starting in the middle. Since x is 0, I don't go left or right at all. Y is 2, so I'm going to go up 2. Then I have the point 4, 0. I start in the middle. I'm going to count 4 to the right. Since y is 0, I don't go up or down at all. I'm going to put a point there. Now I'm going to graph 1, 3 and a half. I'm going to count over 1 and up 3 halves, which is the same as 1.5. So I know that point's going to be between the 1 and the 2. Once I have my points, again, there's nothing stopping me here from having fractions or decimals for my x's or y's. So I'll connect those points to say that I have everything in between. Let's move on to the next question. Okay, here we have a word problem. Aunt Mildred gave you and your brother $10 each to pay for snacks at the movie. You bought 2 large size popcorn and 2 candies and paid $10 for you and your brother. Your friend bought 1 large size popcorn and 6 candies and paid $10. So sometimes as I'm reading through the problems, it helps to just underline what the different numbers that we have are. So we bought 2 popcorns and 2 candies, and we had $10. And then the friend bought 1 popcorn and 6 candies and paid $10. I like to underline the numbers so that when I'm going back to look for them, they're easier to find. So we're going to ask, how much was the price of each candy? And we want to set up some equations that can help us to figure that out. So the first thing we need to do is define our variables. We say, what are the 2 things that we're looking for? Well, I'm trying to find the price of popcorn and the price of candy. So I'm going to let P represent the price of popcorn. And I'm going to let C represent my price of candy. And now I'm going to set up my 2 equations. So for my first equation, I bought 2 large size popcorn and 2 candies and I paid $10. So how would I write that as an equation? Well, 2 things of popcorn times P, my price of popcorn is the total amount that I spent on popcorn, plus 2 candies times C, the price of candy, is the total amount that I spent on candy. So the amount that I spent on popcorn plus the amount that I spent on candy is equal to how much money I spent overall, which was $10. For the second equation, we're going to do the same thing, except this time dealing with what the friend bought. The friend bought 1 popcorn and 6 candies and also spent $10. So I have 1 popcorn times the price of popcorn plus 6 times the price of candy is equal to the $10 that I spent overall. Since I have 2 different variables that I'm trying to find, I know I need 2 different equations in order to find my solutions. Let's go ahead and solve this system through what we call substitution. When I do substitution, I need one of my equations to be solved for one of my variables. So I'm going to notice that my second equation just has 1 P, and I'm going to rewrite this by subtracting 6 from both sides. I'm going to rewrite this equation as P equal to 10 minus 6C. My first step is to solve for one variable. Next, we're going to substitute in this expression for the P in my first equation. Since I know that P is 10 minus 6C, I'm just going to replace the P with that expression. So 2 times 10 minus 6C plus 2C equals 10. Now I have equation that is in one variable, and I can go ahead and solve for C. So the first thing that I do is distribute. 2 times 10 is 20. 2 times negative 6 gives me negative 12C. I bring down the plus 2C, and that's equal to 10. From here, I'm going to combine like terms. Negative 12C and 2C are like terms, so that gives me negative 10C, and this is equal to 10. I just bring that down. Subtract 20 from both sides to get negative 10C equal to negative 10. And lastly, I need to get rid of that coefficient that's next to my C, so I'm going to divide both sides by negative 10, and I get C equals 1. So I have found that the price of candy is $1. I still need to know my price of popcorn. So to find that price of popcorn, I'm going to take what information I found out, that the price of candy is $1, and I'm going to go back to either of my original equations and plug that in. So now that I know my price of candy was $1, if I come back here, popcorn was 10 minus 6C. So I know that the price of popcorn is going to be 10 minus 6. Plug in that 1 that I solved for, and I get that the price of popcorn is then 10 minus 6, which equals 4. So overall, I can write it out as a sentence now. Popcorn cost $4, and candy cost $1. And that is how we could solve this algebraically. Let's look at how could we solve this by graphing. So I have my equations. I'm going to rewrite them on this next screen. I had 2p plus 2c equals 10. And if I go back, I had the equation 1p plus 6c equals 10. So each of those is going to create a line, and if I graph both of them, I can find where they intersect to find my solution. So in order to help me graph, I'm going to create a table. I'm going to put C on one side and P on the other, and just like we did in the earlier examples, I'm going to say, well, what if the price of candy was zero? It doesn't really make sense that something would cost zero, but let's just try it out. I would have 2 times p plus 2 times 0, substituting in that 0 for c, equals 10. And we're working with our first equation still. Okay. We're working with this equation. This gives me 2p plus 2 times 0 is 0, equal to 10. So if 2p equals 10, then I know that p has to equal 5 by dividing both sides by 2. So if my price of candy was 0, then I would have 5 for my popcorn. I need at least 2 points to make a line, so we're going to go back, and this time we're going to put in 0 for p. The reason we pick 0 is because it's such an easy number to work with, because anything times 0 is 0. So if I say, well, what if the price of popcorn was 0 in my first equation? I'm then going to have 2 times 0, putting in the 0 for the p, plus 2 times c equal to 10. And now I can solve that for c. 2 times 0 is 0. So I have 2c equal to 10, dividing both sides by 2 shows me that c would have to be 5. So this is graphing my first line. So I only need 2 points to make a line. I could continue picking values and plugging them in for one side of my table and then finding the other side to get more points, but I'm just going to stop with 2 because that's enough. So here, my graph doesn't have anything labeled, so we need to decide what the different axes represent. And since I listed C first in my table, I'm going to make this be like my x variable. So I'm going to put C on the horizontal axis, and I will put P on the vertical axis. For this problem, there's nothing that really indicates which one is which, so you can choose either way. Now I'm going to plot the point. So I had 0, 5. So I'm going to start at 0, and I'm going to count up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and plot my point 0, 5. Next, I'm going to plot the point 5, 0. So I start in the middle, I count over 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and I plot that point. For this particular problem, since we're dealing with prices, it doesn't make sense to have negative prices. So I'm going to connect my lines because I could have everything in between, but I'm not going to extend them into the other areas of the graph where I would have a negative cost. Okay, my first line is done. Now let's do my second line. Okay. And I'm going to need to clear off a little bit of space, so I'm just going to go ahead and clear out what we have here. Okay, my second equation is 1p plus 6c equals 10. So I'm going to do the same thing, make myself a little table. I'm going to say, well, what if c is 0? If the cost of candy is 0, I have 1p plus 6 times 0 equal to 10. 6 times 0 is 0, and 1p is just p. So p plus 0 equals 10 gives me that p would have to be 10. So I can fill that in on my table. To get my second point, I'm going to say, well, what if p was 0? So I plug that in, and I'm going to go find my other intercept. 1 times 0 plus 6c equals 10. 1 times 0 is 0. So I get 6c equals 10. To solve for c, I need to divide by 6. And I'm going to get that c equals 10 over 6. Well, that's a fraction or a decimal, but that's okay. I can simplify this to the same thing as being 5 over 3. And as a decimal, that would be, we're going to write it as 1.66, because it is 1 2/3. So it would be about $1.67 if we were talking about money. Now I'm going to put those points on my graph. So I had the point 0, 10. So I'm going to go to my graph and I'm going to count up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and put a point at 0, 10. And I'm going to approximate where is 1.670. So I'm going to go over about 1 2/3 and go up 0. And if I connect those points with a nice line, I'm going to say, okay, well, where did my two equations intersect? Because where they intersect is where I'm going to find my solution. So here's the point where they intersect. So what point is that? Well, I went over 1 and up 1, 2, 3, 4, so this is the point 1, 4. And since C was my X and P was my Y, this tells me that the price of candy is $1 and the price of popcorn is $4. And that is the same thing that we got when we solved it algebraically. Okay, that brings us to the end of the pre-lesson 20. We are going to move directly now into lesson 20. So here, looking at our first exercise in lesson 20, we are asked to circle all the ordered pairs x, y that are solutions to the equation 4x minus 10 or minus y equals 10. This is very similar to what we saw in the pre-lesson to figure out which values are solutions. I just take each number and plug it in. So I'm going to try, let's test 3, 2. 4 times 3, putting in the 3 for the x, minus 2 equals 10, and we're going to ask that as a question. Well, 4 times 3 is 12, 12 minus 2 equals 10, 10 equals 10 is true, so this is a solution. Okay, I can do that for every single point and go ahead and test which ones are solutions. So let's try 4 times 2 minus 3. Well, that's 8 minus 3, which is 5. Since 5 is not 10, that is not a solution. Next one. 4 times negative 1 minus negative 14. Well, here we have to be careful a little bit. 4 times negative 1 is negative 4, but minus a negative becomes positive. So that's like negative 4 plus 14, which does equal 10. So that is a solution. Let's test 0, 0. 4 times 0 minus 0, 0 minus 0 equals 0, does not equal 10. So I don't have a solution. Okay, let's test 1, negative 6. 4 times 1 minus negative 6. 4 times 1 is 4. Minus a negative becomes positive, so I have 4 plus 6. That does equal 10, so this is a solution. Let's try 5, 10. 4 times 5 minus 10. 4 times 5 is 20 minus 10. 20 minus 10 is 10, so that is a solution. If I try 0, negative 10, I get 4 times 0 minus negative 10. 4 times 0 is 0, minus a negative becomes positive. 0 plus 10 is 10, so I have a solution. 3, 4. 4 times 3 minus 4. 4 times 3 is 12. Minus 4 is 8, so that's not a solution. Let's try 6, 0. 4 times 6 minus 0. 4 times 6 is 24. Minus 0, that gives me 24. So that is not a solution. Let's try 4, negative 1. I have 4 times 4 minus negative 1. 4 times 4 is 16. Plus 1 is 17. 17 does not equal 10, so that's not a solution. So how did we decide whether or not an ordered pair was a solution? Substitute the first value for x and the second for y and see if you get something that is true. So you could write that out however you wanted, put it in your own words. This is just one way that we could describe our strategy. Okay, looking at the next problem. Here we have our week at a glance, objectives. In lesson 20, we're going to recognize and identify solutions to two variable equations and represent those solutions graphically. And we'll also practice creating two variable equations to represent situations. So for problem 2, we want to discover as many additional solutions to the equation 4x minus y equals 10 as possible. And think about how could we organize our solutions. So if I'm just hunting for answers, I'm going to try and pick any number and put it in for x and figure out what y would give me a solution. So let's see, if I have 1, then I would have 4 times 1 minus y equals 10. 4 minus what y would I need to equal 10? I would need a, I can solve for y, I can subtract 4 from both sides. I get negative y then equals 6, so I would need y equal to negative 6. So that would give me the solution 1, negative 6. Well, I can just try my different x, and in order to stay organized and try and list every single solution, I'm just going to increase my x by 1. So what if x is 2? Then I'd have 4 times 2 minus y equal to 10. 4 times 2 is 8 minus y equal to 10. Solving for y, subtracting 8 from both sides, I get negative y equals 2. So I would need y to equal negative 2. And I can continue in this fashion, just keep picking different x's or even pick different y's and solve for the other variable, and I could find as many solutions as I wanted. When we talk about organizing the solutions, it's good to organize them in some fashion. So either listing it so that your x's are increasing or your y's are increasing, or some way that you can try and see if you have found every possible answer. Let's look at part B now. We need to find 5 solutions where one or more variables are negative numbers or non-integer values. And we want to think about, well, what strategy do we have? Well, if I want to guarantee that one variable is a negative number, let me just try putting in a negative number. So if I put in negative 1 for x, let x be negative 1, I would have 4 times negative 1 minus y equal to 10. 4 times negative 1 is negative 4, so I have negative 4 minus y equals to 10. I can solve for y by adding 4 to both sides, so I get negative y equals 14, so y equals negative 14. And we did see that solution earlier, but again, I'm just going over what would be my strategy for finding these solutions. So I could try x as negative 2. If I do 4 times negative 2 minus y, I get negative 8 minus y equals 10. Adding 8 to both sides gives negative y equals 18. So I would need y equals negative 18. We also can have solutions that have non-integer values. When we say non-integer values, we're talking about something that is a fraction or a decimal. So let me see, what would I get if I put in 1/2 for x? 4 times 1/2 minus y equals 10. Now I'm going to solve this for y. Well, 4 times 1/2 is like 4 divided by 2, so that's 2 minus y equals 10. Subtracting 2 from both sides would give us negative y equals 8, so I need y to equal negative 8. Okay, now let's try, what if I put in 1/4? I can put 1/4 in for my x. I'll have 4 times 1/4 minus y equals 10. 4 times 1/4 gives me 1 minus y equals 10. Subtracting 1 from both sides, negative y equals 9. So I need that y equals negative 9. And I could continue in this fashion, picking whatever x's I wanted, plugging them in, solving for y, and I could find as many different points as I want. So you can, on your own, try and find a 5th solution that has either a negative number or a non-integer value. So for part C, how many ordered pairs, x, y, will be in the solution set of the equation 4x minus y equals 10? Well, since I can pick any number that I want, and there are infinitely many numbers that I could pick, I know that there will also be infinitely many numbers in the solution set. So now we want to create a visual representation of our solution set by plotting each solution that we found in our plane. So I'm going to have to flip back and forth a little bit. What solutions did I have? 1, negative 6 was one of my points, so I can plot that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And this is where it would help if we had them organized in some kind of a table or some other system of organization. So I had 2, negative 2 was a point. Okay, what else do I have? I have the point 1/2, negative 8. I can put that on there. 1/2, negative 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. if I go back and look before, we had the points 3, 2, and 5, 10. So I'll also put those on there. So 3, 2, 4, 5, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And I can put all of those different points on there, and we are going to notice that they start to form a line. And because I can pick any point that I want, I can pick any fraction or any decimal, I'm going to have every single value between these. So I would connect my dots to make the line. So question E says, why does it make sense to represent the solution to the equation 4x minus y equals 10 as a line in the coordinate plane? Well, it is impossible for me to list out every single decimal and every single point. So it makes sense to draw a line because that's the only way to show all the solutions. I can't list them out as ordered pairs. I wouldn't be able to list out infinitely many points, or even using an etc., find a pattern that would list them all out. The only way to show all the solutions is through the line. So let's look at number 2. The sum of two numbers is 25. What are the numbers? I'm going to create my equation using my variables to represent the situation. So I need to say, what are my two variables? Well, let's have x be one number. X is one number. And we're going to say, let y be another number. Since the sum is 25, I would know x plus y equals 25. So to list at least 6 solutions to the equation you created, we're just going to try values. If x is 1, 1 plus 24 is 25. If x is 2, 2 plus 23 is 25. If x is 3, 3 plus 22 is 25. If x is 5, 5 plus 20 is 25. If x is 10, 10 plus 15 is 25. I can pick whatever x's I want, and I can list them out. So I need at least 6, so let me do one more. If x was 0, then 0 20 plus 25 would equal 25. So now I want to create a graph that represents my solution set. So since all of these numbers that I have are very large, I'm going to have to create an appropriate scale so that I can get those 20s and 15s and 23s on my graph. So I am going to count by, two so that I can get up to 20. So let's say, let's have this be 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20. And over here we'll just go ahead and count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, depending on how you label your axes, your graph will look a little bit different. So now I'm going to get the point, okay, let's see, what other points did I have? 520 was one of my points, so that's up here. I can find more by saying if I had 6, I would need 19. So 619 would be here. If I had 7, I would need 18. So 718 would be here. And I recognize that my points will continue in this fashion. So I can continue plotting all my different points. Once I have all the points, I would go ahead and create a line. Because since I can have any number, I can include decimals, I can include fractions, so I would add everything in between. Okay, let's look at the next problem. Gia had 25 songs in a playlist composed of songs from her two favorite artists, Beyonce and Jennifer Lopez. How many songs did she have by each one in the playlist? This question is very similar to the one that we just did. We're going to create an equation using our two variables. So let's have x be the number of Beyonce songs, and let y represent the number of Jennifer Lopez songs. And I know that I have 25 songs in total, so I know x plus y has to equal 25. So list at least three solutions to the equation. Well, if I have 5 songs by Beyoncé, then I would have 25 by Jennifer Lopez. If I have 10 here, I have 15 here. I can pick any two numbers that I want that add up to 25. So I can even say 0 and 25. Now let's create a graph of this situation. Okay. Since I don't have any graph paper, I'm just going to sketch something. And I'm going to label my different axes. I have my x and my y. And I'll go ahead and I'll count by 5. So 5, 10, 15, 20. 25, and I'll do the same thing on my x. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. And now I'm going to put those points on there. Well, if I have the point 5, 20, I have 10, 15, 0, 25. Now here, in the previous exercise, we simply connected all the dots that we had because we could have every single point in between. But let's consider this situation. I'm talking about a specific number of songs that I have by each artist. Since it doesn't make sense to say that I would have half of a song by one artist or 0.3 songs from a different artist, I can't connect all my dots. I can only put the ones that have integer solutions. So they are still going to form a line, but it's going to be a series of discrete points. So if I have 15 here, I have 10 here, and I would have every single one in between. I can have 21 and 4, but I can't have 20 and a half. Okay, so imagine we fill in each one of those dots, and since this is just a rough sketch, this is going to be a little bit imprecise. But we get the idea. Okay, so now we want to compare exercise 3 to exercise 4. Well, exercise 3 created a smooth line. So here I'll write, what did we know about exercise 3? It was a smooth line or a connected line. We had decimals and fractions included. But exercise 4 only had points. We couldn't have fractions or decimals. Another thing that we could notice for exercise 3, since I was just talking about two numbers, it made sense to have negative answers. So we had negative numbers. But if I was talking about a certain number of songs, like in exercise 4, it wouldn't make sense to have a negative number of songs by Beyoncé, so I can't include negative numbers. So in exercise 3, because I had all these different fractions and decimals, I had infinite solutions. But in exercise 4, I can either have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., up to 25 songs by Beyoncé. There aren't any other possibilities, so I have finite solutions, which means I could list them all out. Okay, so looking at our lesson summary here, we have seen that an ordered pair is a solution to a two-variable equation. When each number substituted into its corresponding variable makes the equation a true number sentence. And all of our solutions to the two-variable equation are called the solution set. And we've seen that each ordered pair of numbers in the solution set of the equation corresponds to a point on the coordinate plane, and the set of all such points in the coordinate plane is called the graph of the equation. Thank you very much for joining us today and watching our next video.